This road reminds me of a story I read in the Bible about another God follower by the name of Philip. One day Philip was sitting in his bed in Acts 8 chapter, and an angel came to him and woke him up and said, "Philip, get up and take the back road, go from Jerusalem to Gaza." Well, I wonder why the angel came to Philip. Why didn't he not come to Matthew, Mark, Luke, or John? And I think somewhere in Philip's life, he said to God, "I'll be your willing witness. I'll go any place, anywhere, anytime, under any circumstances. When you, God, you need me, you just wake me up and I will go anywhere. And when you speak to me, my next heartbeat is a heartbeat of obedience." And the Bible said Philip arose and went, because his next heartbeat was a heartbeat of obedience. And he was walking down the back road, and all of a sudden he ran into another man on the back road, a guy called Ethiopian eunuch in the Bible. And he is a special guy because he was a secretary of treasure for the Queen of Candace, which is the Queen of Ethiopia. And he was in his chariot reading the prophet Isaiah. Now here's Philip coming down the road. Here comes the Ethiopian eunuch. And he'd been reading the scripture and he'd understand. And also Philip sees him and says, "Do you understand what you're reading?" He said, "Well, how can I unless somebody comes and explains it to me?" And all of a sudden the Spirit of the Lord spoke to Philip and said, "Run and get in the chariot." And since his next heartbeat was a heartbeat of obedience, Philip ran and got in the chariot with the Ethiopian eunuch and began to explain to him the things of God. In fact, the scripture says he began to take Isaiah and explain to him Jesus. Now we'll give the Ethiopian eunuch a title too. Let's call him a seeking soul. A seeking soul is someone who the Holy Spirit is already working on before you get there. See, God's Spirit is working on people all around the world, and what happened is they're trying to find God. They have a sensitivity to the things of God, but they have no one explain it to them. And what God tries to do is bring a willing witness and a seeking soul together, and when those two come together, you have what we call the divine encounter. So Philip got into the chariot and began to explain to the Ethiopian eunuch the things of God, and he sees the water and he says to Philip, "Stop! what prevents me from being baptized?" And Philip said, "Do you believe in Jesus?" He said, "Yeah, I do." And so they went down the water and Philip baptized him, and he came out of the water, and all of a sudden the Bible says the Spirit of the Lord snatched Philip out of the water and he found himself in a city called Azotus. Where's Azotus? I have no clue where Azotus is. But he never made it to Gaza. He said, why did God put him in Azotus? Because I think God needs another willing witness. And when God uses him, his next heartbeat's a heartbeat of obedience. See, that's why God wants from you. He wants you to become his willing witness. You say to God somewhere in your life, and maybe you've already done it. If you haven't done it, you need to do so today. You need to say to God, "I'll go any place, anywhere, anytime, under any circumstances. And God, when you speak to me, my next heartbeat is a heartbeat of obedience." And I found out something. Your obedience is usually someone else's salvation. It was for the Ethiopian eunuch when Philip obeyed God. Who's God going to move you to? Who's your next seeking soul? Become a willing witness for him. And maybe then somebody else will be baptized and become a God follower because of you. As I told you a story about Philip and the Ethiopian eunuch, it reminds me of a story what happened to me one time as a God follower. I said to God one day I'd be a willing witness. I'd go any place, anywhere, anytime, under any circumstances. And lo and behold, God had asked me to go to Budapest, Hungary to work in the country of Hungary where only 2% know Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. And so I took a group of students and we landed Saturday night, and Sunday morning we'd get up and we're supposed to go to the tram station, take the tram to the subway, take the subway to the bus station and catch bus number 16 and go out to where we're going to work in a village that day. And well, most of the kids had never been overseas before, so when they got up on Sunday morning, they had jet lag and they're walking around, they're stumbling and they're trying to figure out which door was men, which one was women, and the girls were sticking their 110 hair dryer into a 220 socket, and next thing you know, you heard like that, and their hair dryer was melting, and they were crying. And I was telling the students, "Hurry, we need to get going because it's time for us to go to the tram, to catch the tram to the subway to the bus station." So finally, we all got together and we started walking and we got to the tram, and I looked at the sign on the tram station. It said, "The tram comes every 9 minutes." Well, we've been waiting 30 minutes for the next 9 minute tram. And you know what those signs mean in Eastern Europe? Absolutely nothing. The tram come when it comes and it goes when it goes, and all you can do is wait. So finally the tram come up, we got on it, we went down to the last stop where the subway station was at. We walked down into the subway station and then down to the subway, and They're sitting in the subway waiting for us. I told the students, hurry, let's get on the subway. So we're kind of walking fast toward the subway, and as soon as we get to the subway, it closes the door, pulls off, leaving us on the dock. Now we have to wait for the next subway. So we waited and waited and waited, and finally the next subway pulled up, and we got on it, went down three stops, and walked up to the bus station, and there was bus number 16 waiting for us. It was empty. So I told the students, let's hurry and let's run and get on this bus before it pulls away. So like 20 of us, we're running, you know, a mad dash toward the bus, and the bus driver looks out and sees us coming toward him, and he panics and he closes the door on his bus and he pulls off, leaving us in the dust. Now we have to wait for the next bus, and it didn't come for another 30 minutes. And so we're waiting, and finally it comes up, and I can't believe it. I can't believe it. It's totally packed. I mean, it is so full, you can't hardly get another person. I told the kids, I said, there's three doors, half of you on the back door, half of you on the middle door, and I'm going on the front door to talk to the bus driver and make sure we get off the right stop. So we're trying to get in the bus, and the bus driver's trying to close the door, catching our body in the door, and we're all trying to get in, and we're like sardines, and finally the last one gets in, the bus door closed, and he takes off. Well, in Europe, you don't sit down on the bus, you usually stand hanging by a plastic strap, and the reason I really get on the front door is to talk to the bus driver. But another reason I get on the front door, because usually in Europe they don't wear deodorant, so every time all the air goes through all the armpits and get to the back, it smells pretty bad. And the second thing, they don't shave their armpits, so I usually stuck my grandma, and she's got a bush hanging out, and you want to take a weed eater to it, and tell her, trim that thing down. And so I'm hanging off there and for dear life, and on that plastic strap, and I look at the back of the bus. And on the very back of the bus, I see a boy has a cap on that says J.C. Well, in America, J.C. stands for Jesus Christ. And I begin to wonder if that boy was a believer. All of a sudden, the Holy Spirit spoke to me and says, Walker, go find out. And since I'm a willing witness, my next heartbeat's a heartbeat of, you got it, obedience. So I start making my way back to the back of the bus there, and I got to the back, and I tapped the boy on the shoulder, and he turns around. I said to him, I said, do you speak English? I don't know why we talk loud at people in foreign countries, but we do. And he said, yes, I speak English very well. I said, oh, I said, my name is Walker Moore, and I'm a missionary from the United States. And I want to know, are you a believer in the Lord Jesus Christ? He said, yes, I am. He said, last summer, I was saved at an English as a second language camp. I said, I'm looking for some people to hire to work as interpreters this summer, and I want you to be available. He goes, stop. So my name is Kuman Kovach. This is my friend Sylvie. He pointed to a girl standing beside him. He said, Friday night we graduated from high school. And they asked us at our high school graduation, what do you want to do with your life? And we said to them, we want to be a missionary for the Lord Jesus Christ. But the problem is, we don't know where his employment office. Where do you go to work for Jesus Christ? You go to McDonald's to work for McDonald's, and you go to Burger King to work for Burger King. Where do you go to work for Jesus Christ? So we did not know where to go. So last night, Sylvie and I prayed all night long. We prayed, God, please send someone to us that will use us for the kingdom. And he said, we prayed and we prayed and we prayed, God, please send someone to us that will use us for the kingdom. I said, Kuman, here I am. Well, I learned something that day in my life. My next heartbeat of obedience, God was moving towards somebody who needed me to touch their life. But also I learned that my disappointment is God's divine appointments. See, God moves willing witness through disappointment. When the tram was late, and if all those things were on time, I would miss the bus that had those two people on it that needed me to come and hire them for the kingdom of God. Now, what are the odds of me being on a bus in a city, 2 million people, where two kids prayed all night long before for God to send someone their way? What are the odds of that happening? I know the answer to that. It's 100%. See, God is always moving us toward those divine encounters. And my heart beats a heartbeat of obedience. My obedience is usually someone else's salvation. And my disappointment are God's divine appointments. See, that's the journey of being a willing witness. Is God takes you any place, anywhere, anytime, and you never know where you're going to be. You might find yourself in Africa. You might find yourself beneath a bunch of wasp nests. Or you might find yourself going across the street to tell people about Jesus. Or you're a willing witness. Be one today. Sometimes God asks us to leave the the busyness of our life and to take another trail, another path. And those who live beneath the authority of God, then their next heartbeat's a heartbeat of obedience. I understand that. Sometimes the busyness of the world dims the voice of God. And sometimes you can't hardly hear Him because you're so busy. But the Bible's full of God followers. That's just like the world. Busy. They looked over at me for a second and went on. But the people in the Bible, the God followers, they had something different. They heard the voice of God. The next thing you know, they were going on a path that many times was alone and by themselves. Abraham, when he's called out Ur of Chaldee, no one else has ever been a God follower like him before. And he left his home and just started following God. Noah, Jonah, the Bible's full of Moses. All of them left the business of life and they followed God. Their next heartbeat was a heartbeat of obedience. See, missionary work is not a one-time plan event. It's a lifestyle. And that's what we're trying to say to you today. Maybe you need to get off the businessness of your life. You're involved in football and activities and cheerleading and you got so many things going on. If God spoke to you, can you get off the busy highway of life and take that lonely path? That path to adventure, excitement. Can you handle it? I bet you can. May your next heartbeat be a heartbeat of obedience.